second out in the stop, bro.
Hey, yo. Childish, you're a fool. You're a fool for this one, but I love it. I love it, dude. I could do a whole fucking lecture on this video and that could last 5 hours and put it like, dude, you're a fucking genius, bro. You're a fucking genius, dude. You are so tapped into your black mentality, to your black mentalness. You know what I mean? I know that I just fucked up 10% of the English language with those two words right there, but I'm just saying, bro, y'all know what I mean. And it was because of this that Solo, A Star Wars Story, did not do what he was supposed to do, yo. Their white folks was not feeling you after this one. You know what I mean? Like, man. Yo, by far my favorite part in this whole video, I ain't even gonna lie, the whole thing is great. Every symbolic part is like that. Is the part where you poked your head in looked in the church and with the how in 5 seconds you broke down how white dominance has infiltrated black greatness for centuries, just in the midst of about going about doing it, how you poked your head in there a little bit and then see what's going on, and then you came in, imitate what they was doing for about 2-3 seconds, and then all of a sudden stopped and looked and thought about it. You realize, oh, my whiteness just took back over. How the fuck am I joining these niggas? And then here the weapon comes. Let me kill that shit off, you know what I mean? Like, but I digress. I can't say, man. I'm a student of history. You gotta know your history now, man.
No bull.
we're gonna get back out to Boston. They ain't going nowhere. We're gonna get back to Boston. But I already told you now where that thing from. This book right here, it say to white people right here. Why I'm no longer talking to white people about race. Barnes & Noble's don't have it in this store. They might have it online, but you know, when you got a business way, 97.6% of the people who walk in there and purchase and spend time and browse through their books are white people. You don't want a book that's titled "Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race." It makes sense. I get it. It's a business decision, but it's also an American decision. Nina Simone was awesome, y'all. Love that woman. This is by Renee Edo Lodge. In 2014, award-winning journalist Renee Edo Lodge wrote about her frustrations with the way that these discussions of race and racism in Britain was being led by those who were not affected by it. She posted a piece on her blog and gave it a title, "Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race." Her words hit a nerve. The post went viral and comments flooded in from others desperate to speak up about their own experiences. Galvanized by this clear hunger for an open discussion, she decided to dig into the source of these feelings. The result is a searing, illuminating, absolutely necessary examination of what it is to be a person of color in Britain today. Exploring issues from eradicated black history to the political purpose of white dominance, whitewashed feminism to the inextricable link between class and race, Renee Edo Lodge offers a new framework of how to see, acknowledge, and counter racism today. Full of clear, bold, and keenly felt arguments. Yes, it is. Yo. Renee, you killed it. You the second Renee that I've known in my life, and I don't even know you, you know what I mean? The first Renee, Trinidadian sister, you know what I mean? So, like, yeah, like, what up, Miss Matt? I know it's Alpha doing this. Yo, Renee, you know why I'm laughing at this? Because I can picture you laughing right there. Anyone who's walked with Renee in a pharmacy, a hospital center pharmacy, yo, y'all know what I mean. She probably shaking her head right now, taking her glasses off, dying laughing because tears wanted to hide. What's up, Renee? I miss y'all, yo. What's up? What's going on? How's the little one doing? Alright. But yeah, this book is full of clear, bold, and keenly felt argument. Renee, you killed it, girl. You, yeah, see the head thing in this book right there. "Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race" is a wake-up call to a nation in denial about the structural and institutional racism occurring at its heart. It is a timely, essential book by a vital new voice. Renee Edo Lodge is a London-based award-winning journalist. She has written for the New York Times, The Voice, Daily Telegraph, Guardian, Independent, Stylist, Inside Housing, The Pool, Days and Confused, and The New Humanist. She is the winner of an MHP 32 Watch Award and was chosen as one of the top 30 young people in digital media by The Guardian in 2014. She has been listed in Elle's 100 Inspirational Women's list and The Root's 30 Black Viral Voices Under 30. Edo Lodge contributed to The Good Immigrant. Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race is her first book. RenéEdoLodge.co.uk at Rene, designed by Greg Heineman. Author photograph by Amal Saad. It's published by Bloomsbury Circus, London, Oxford, New York, New Delhi, Sydney. An imprint of Bloomsbury Publishing PLC. Bloomsbury and the Down and logo and the trademarks of Bloomsbury Publishing, first published in Great Britain in 2017. Last year, Rene Edo Lodge 2017 for TNT. Content, you got the preface, chapter one is histories, chapter two is the system, chapter three is what is white privilege, chapter four, fear of a black planet, chapter five, the feminism question, chapter six, race and class, chapter seven, there is no justice, there is just us. You got the notes, the bibliography, acknowledgement, then the index. Preface. On February 22nd, 2014, I published a post on February 24th, 2014. You were in the middle of your first trimester of development. Seven days later, 2014 was a leap year, right? It was a leap year. Yeah, 7 days later, yo. 7 days later was the last day I saw your mom. While Sister Renee here was putting words to screen and sending a shock to the system. You were 2 months fetus, and 7 days later, without neither one of us knowing it, God knows what God does, why he does it, when he does it, I guess, so. It's been, yes, that long. It's been 5 years this year. It's gonna be 5 years next year. It feels like it's been 20 years, but you know, it's going to be 5 years, yeah. Now we're going to get to that on the Oprah interview. If somebody don't take me out before that. What up, Al? On 22nd February 2014, I have to let y'all know this book was written by somebody in England. So a lot of like the dates, some of the words, some of the terminology and whatnot is going to be a little different to an American listener, but it's okay. You're living in America, learn some other shit about someone else that's not about you in your neighborhood. Nah, man, I don't give a fuck if you don't get it. I was trying to preface it a little bit, but then I realized that, you know what? If you don't know something about outside of where you at, it's your fault. You're dumber than dumb. It's like, now let me stop, yo. Let me let Nina sing it. Preface. On 22nd February 2014, I published a post on my blog. I titled it, Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race. It read, I'm no longer engaging with white people on the topic of race. Not all white people, just the vast majority who refuse to accept the legitimacy of structural racism and its symptoms. I can no longer engage with the gulf of an emotional disconnect that white people display when a person of color articulates their experience. You can see their eyes shut down and harden. It's like treacle is poured into their ears, blocking up their ear canals. It's like they can no longer hear us. This emotional disconnect is the conclusion of living a life oblivious to the fact that their skin color is the norm and all others deviate from it. At best, white people have been taught not to mention that people of color are different in case it offends us. They truly believe that the experiences of their life as a result of their skin color can and should be universal. I just cannot engage with the bewilderment and the defensiveness as they try to grapple with the fact that not everyone experiences the world in the way that they do. They've never had to think about what it means in power terms to be white. So anytime they are vaguely reminded of this fact, they interpret it as an affront. Their eyes glaze over in boredom or widen in indignation. Their mouths start twitching as they get defensive. Their throats open up as they try to interrupt, itching to talk over you but not really listen, because they need to let you know that you've got it wrong. The journey towards understanding structural racism still requires people of color to prioritize white feelings. Even if they can hear you, they're not really listening. It's like something happens to the words as they leave our mouths and reach their ears. The words hit a barrier of denial and they don't get any further. That's the emotional disconnect. It's not really surprising because they've never known what it means to embrace a person of color as a true equal with thoughts and feelings that are as valid as their own. Watching The Color of Fear by Lee Moon-Wa. Yo, I hadn't seen that thing until I read it here. Yeah, I gotta see that. Watching The Color of Fear by Lee Moon-Wa, I saw people of color break down in tears as they struggled to convince a defiant white man that his words were enforcing and perpetuating a white racist standard on them. All the while, he stared obliviously, completely confused by this pain, at best trivializing it, at worst ridiculing it. I've written before about this white denial being the ubiquitous politics of race that operates on its inherent invisibility. So I can't talk to white people about race anymore because of the consequent denials, awkward cartwheels, and mental acrobatics that they display when this is brought to their attention. Who really wants to be alerted of a structural system that benefits them at the expense of others? I love the British, yo. The British are so goddamn honest. But yeah. Who really wants to be alerted to a structural system that benefits them at the expense of others? I can no longer have this conversation because we are often coming at it from completely different places. I can't have a conversation with them about the details of a problem if they don't even recognize that the problem exists. Worse still is a white person who might be willing to entertain the possibility of said racism, but who thinks we enter this conversation as equals. We don't. Not to mention that entering into conversation with defiant white people is a frankly dangerous task for me. As the heckles rise and the defiance grows, I have to tread incredibly carefully, because if I express frustration, anger, or exasperation at their refusal to understand, they will tap into their pre-subscribed racist tropes about angry black people who are a threat to them and their safety. It's very likely that they will then paint me as a bully or an abuser. It's also likely that their white friends will rally around them, rewrite history, and make the lies the truth. Trying to engage with them and navigate their racism is not worth that. Amid every conversation about nice white people feeling silenced by conversations about race, there is a sort of ironic and glaring lack of understanding or empathy for those of us who have been visibly marked as different for our entire lives and live the consequences. It's truly a lifetime of self-censorship that people of color have to live. The options are speak your truth and face the reprisals, or bite your tongue and get ahead in life. It must be a strange life, always having permission to speak and feeling indignant when you're finally asked to listen. It stems from white people's never questioned entitlement, I suppose. I cannot continue to emotionally exhaust myself trying to get this message across, while also towing a very precarious line that tries not to implicate any one white person in their role of perpetuating structural racism, lest their character assassinate me. So I'm no longer talking to white people about race. I don't have a huge amount of power to change the way the world works, but I can set boundaries. I can halt the entitlement they feel towards me, and I'll start there by stopping the conversation. The balance is too far swung in their favor. Their intent is often not to listen or learn, but to exert their power, to prove me wrong, to emotionally drain me, and to rebalance the status quo. I'm not talking to white people about race unless I absolutely have to. If there's something like a media or conference appearance that means that someone might hear what I'm saying and feel less alone, then I'll participate. But I'm no longer dealing with people who don't want to hear it, wish to ridicule it, or frankly, don't deserve it. I never read this blog in February 2014. And I mean, so I did not know this was out then. I just picked up this book last year. Yeah. But I can imagine how powerful that must have been. That was awesome. After I press publish and the blog post took on a life of its own. Years later, I still meet new people in different countries and different situations who tell me that they've read it. In 2014, as the post was being linked to all over the internet, I braced myself for the usual slew of racist comments. But the response was markedly different, so much so that it surprised me. There was a clear racial split in how the post was received. I got lots of messages from black and brown people. There were many thank yous and lots of you've articulated my experience. There were reports of tears and a little bit of debate about how to approach the problem, with education being rated highly as a solution to bridge the communication gap. Reading these messages was a relief. I knew how difficult it is to put that feeling of frustration into words. So when people got in contact and thanked me for explaining something they'd always struggled to, I was glad that it had served them. I knew that if I was feeling less alone, then they were feeling less alone too. What I wasn't expecting was an outpouring of emotion from white people who felt that by deciding to stop talking to white people about race, I was taking something away from the world, and that this was an absolute tragedy. Heartbreaking seemed to be the word that best described this sentiment. I'm so damn sorry you have been made to feel like this, one commenter wrote. As a white person, I'm painfully embarrassed by the systemic privilege we deny and enjoy on a daily basis, and painfully embarrassed that I did not even realize it myself until about 10 years ago. Another commenter pleaded, "Don't stop talking to white people. Your voice is clear and important, and there are ways of getting through." Another one, this time from a black commenter, read, "It would be such a painstaking task to persuade people, but we should not stop." And a final, definitive comment read simply, "Please don't give up on white people." I feel that commenter. We not, you know what I mean? White all over the world, like, we just so y'all know, take it from me, we ain't never give up on y'all. Y'all just never gave us a chance to start, you know what I mean? I'm just saying, put it this way, think about it. Whether it's in England, whether it's in America, whether it's in South Africa, whether it's in even Africa where you got, I mean, today, whether it's in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, against the Chinese and all that. We ain't giving up on y'all. We ain't never give up on y'all, because we know y'all just gotta look in y'all hearts and realize that, yeah, y'all just ain't never give us a chance to start. And it's been like 600 years since y'all ain't never give us a chance. You know what I mean? So, does that make sense? Although these responses were sympathetic, they were evidence of the same communication gap I'd written about in the blog post. There seemed to be a misunderstanding of who this piece of writing was for. It was never written with the intention of prompting guilt in white people or to provoke any kind of epiphany. I didn't know at the time that I had inadvertently written a breakup letter to whiteness. And I didn't expect white readers to do the internet equivalent of standing outside my bedroom window with a boombox and a bunch of flowers, confessing their flaws and mistakes, begging me not to leave. This all seemed strange and uncomfortable to me, because in writing that blog post, all I had felt I was saying was that I had had enough. It wasn't a cry for help or a groveling plea for white people's understanding and compassion. It wasn't an invitation for white people to indulge in self-flagellation. I stopped talking to white people about race because I don't think giving up is a sign of weakness. Sometimes it's about self-preservation. I've turned why I'm no longer talking to white people about race into a book, paradoxically, to continue the conversation. Since I set my boundary, I've done almost nothing but speak about race and music festivals and in TV studios, to secondary school pupils and political party conferences. And the demand for this conversation shows no sign of subsiding. People want to talk about it. This book is a product of 5 years of agitation, frustration, exhausting explanations, and paragraph-long Facebook comments. It's about not just the explicit side, but the slippery side of racism. Yo. Girl, you can write. Try to tell you, man. Your mind is just, yeah. I literally, if it wasn't for the fact that I stumbled upon Dr. King's Why We Can't Wait, I was going to close out this project with rereading this book last. It's going to start with Black Power, the Politics of Liberation, written in 67, and then this, Why I'm No Longer Talking to White People About Race, written in 2017, a 50-year bracket. I'm actually, you know, that's why I was going with it. Cool, you can write them. Did you get that line she just said? It's about not just the explicit side, but the slippery side of racism. The bits that are hard to define, and the bits that make you doubt yourself. Britain is still profoundly uncomfortable with race and difference. Since I wrote that blog post in 2014, things have changed a lot for me. I now spend most of my time talking to white people about race. The publishing industry is very white. So there's no way I could have got this book published without talking to at least some white people about race. And in my research, I've had to talk to white people I never thought I'd ever exchange words with, including former British National Party leader Nick Griffin. I know a lot of people think he shouldn't be given a platform for his views to be aired unchallenged, and I agonized over the interview on page 123. I'm not the first person with a platform to give Nick Griffin airtime, but I hope I've handled his words responsibly. A quick word on definitions. In this book, the phrase people of color is used to define anyone of any race that isn't white. I've used it because it's an infinitely better definition than simply non-white, a moniker that brings with it a suggestion of something lacking or a deficiency. I use the word black in this book to describe people of African and Caribbean heritage, including mixed race people. I quote a lot of research, so you will occasionally read the phrase black and minority ethnic or BME. It's not a term I like very much because it conjures thoughts of clinical diversity monitoring forms. But in the interest of interpreting the research as accurately as possible, I have chosen to stick to it. I write and read to assure myself that other people have felt what I'm feeling too, that it isn't just me, that this is real and valid and true. I am only acutely aware of race because I've been rigorously marked out as different by the world I know for as long as I can remember. Although I analyze invisible whiteness and ponder its exclusionary nature often, I watch as an outsider. I understand that this isn't the case for most white people, who move through the world blissfully unaware of their own race until its dominance is called into question. When white people pick up a magazine, scroll through the internet, read a newspaper, or switch on the TV, it is never rare or odd to see people who look like them in positions of power or exerting authority. In culture particularly, The positive affirmations of whiteness are so widespread that the average white person doesn't even notice them. Instead, these affirmations are placidly consumed. To be white is to be human. To be white is universal. I only notice because I am not. I tell y'all, I told y'all this girl could write. Man. I told y'all that girl could write, y'all. Trying to tell you. I told y'all that girl could write. I told y'all this girl could write, y'all. So I'm going to go back a little bit, y'all. When white people pick up a magazine, scroll through the internet, read a newspaper, or switch on the TV, it is never rare or odd to see people who look like them in positions of power or exerting authority. In culture particularly, the positive affirmations of whiteness are so widespread that the average white person doesn't even notice them. Instead, their affirmations are placidly consumed. To be white is to be human. To be white is universal. I only know this because I am not. I've written this book to articulate that feeling of having your voice and confidence snatched away from you in the cocky face of the status quo. It has been written to counter the lack of the historical knowledge and the political backdrop you need to anchor your opposition to racism. I hope you use it as a tool. I won't ever stop myself from speaking about race. Every voice raised against racism chips away at its power. We cannot afford to stay silent. This book is an attempt to speak. Before I get into chapter one of this, I gotta go back real quick. I gotta go back to my man, Don Miguel Ruiz. Now we left off with him back in like the first 10 episodes, you know what I mean? So we're gonna go back to him real quick. Chapter 2, the first agreement. Be impeccable with your word. The first agreement is the most important one and also the most difficult one to honor. It is so important that with just this first agreement, you will be able to transcend to the level of existence I call heaven on earth. The first agreement is to be impeccable with your words. It sounds very simple, but it is very, very powerful. Why your word? Your word is the power that you have to create. Your word is a gift that comes directly from God. The Gospel of John in the Bible, speaking of the creation of the universe, says, "In the beginning there was a word, and the word was with God, and the word is God." Through the word you express your creative power. It is through the word that you manifest everything. Regardless of what language you speak, your intent manifests through the word. What you dream, what you feel, what you really are will all be manifested through the word. The word is not just a sound or a written symbol. The word is a force. It is the power you have to express and communicate, to think, and thereby to create the events in your life. You can speak. What other animal on the planet can speak? The word is the most powerful tool you have as a human. It is a tool of magic. But like a sword with two edges, your word can create the most beautiful dream, or your word can destroy everything around you. Dumb truck. I'm sorry, I had to go there. But yeah. Rosa Sander. The word is the most powerful tool you have as a human. It is the tool of magic. But like a sword with two edges, your word can create the most beautiful dream, or your word can destroy everything around you. One edge is the misuse of the word, which creates a living hell. The other edge is the impeccability of the word, which will only create beauty, love, and heaven on earth. Depending upon how it is used, the word can set you free, or it can enslave you even more than you know. All the magic you possess is based on your word. Your word is pure magic, and misuse of your word is black magic. Why had to be black magic? Why couldn't it be white magic? White devil magic.
Say, now let me stop, yo. Let me leave whiteness alone, man.
This crack is going to shoot me twice. Make sure I don't come back. But it won't stop now. It can't hit now. The word is so powerful that one word can change a life or destroy the lives of millions of people. Some years ago, one man in Germany, by the use of the word, manipulated a whole country of the most intelligent people. He led them into a world war with just the power of his word. He convinced others to commit the most atrocious act of violence. He activated people's fear with the word, and like a big explosion, there was killing and war all over the world. Hey, I hate to be the historical bearer of bad news, but doesn't this guy sound like he just described Trump as Adolf Hitler or Adolf Hitler as Trump? He activated people's fear with the word, and like a big explosion, there was killing and war all over. All over the world, humans destroyed other humans because they were afraid of each other. Hitler's words, based on fear-generated beliefs and agreements, will be remembered for centuries. The human mind is like a fertile ground where seeds are continually being planted. These seeds are opinions, ideas, and concepts. You plant a seed, a thought, and it grows. The word is like a seed, and the human mind is so fertile. The only problem is that too often it is fatal for the seeds of fear. You plant a seed, a thought, and it grows. The word is like a seed, and the human mind is so fertile. The only problem is too often it is fatal for the seeds of fear. Every human mind is fertile, but only for those kinds of seeds it is prepared for. What is important is to see which kinds of seeds our mind is fertile for, and to prepare it to receive the seeds of love. Take the example of Hitler. He sent out all those seeds of fear, and they grew very strong and beautifully achieved massive destruction. Seeing the awesome power of the word, we must understand what power comes out of our mouths. One fear or doubt planted in our mind can create an endless drama of events. One word is like a spell, and humans use the word like black magicians, thoughtlessly putting spells on one another. Every human is a magician, and we can either put a spell on someone with our word, or we can release someone from a spell. We cast spells all the time with our opinions. An example, I see a friend and give him an opinion that just popped into my mind. I said, I see that kind of color in your face in people who are going to get cancer. If he listens to the word and if he agrees, he will have cancer in less than 1 year. That is the power of the word. During our domestication, our parents and siblings gave their opinions about us without even thinking. We believed those opinions and we lived in fear over these opinions, like not being good at swimming or sports or riding. Someone gives an opinion and says, look, this girl is ugly. The girl listens, believes she is ugly, and grows up with the idea that she is ugly. It doesn't matter how beautiful she is, as long as she has that agreement, she will believe that she is ugly. That is the spell she is under. By hooking our attention, the word can enter our mind and change a whole belief for better or for worse. Another example, you may believe you are stupid and you may have believed this for as long as you can remember. This agreement can be very tricky, causing you to do a lot of things just to ensure that you are stupid. You may do something and think to yourself, I wish I was smart, but I must be stupid or I wouldn't have done that. The mind goes in hundreds of different directions, and we can spend days getting hooked by just that one belief in our own stupidity. If I fucked up reading this book the way I'm reading it, go pick it up yourself and read it. What up, Trey? I just walked with this brother named Trey, right? He was the second other person I've seen holding this book reading it, you know what I mean? It's so funny, the last day I worked at a job at McKesson was actually the day this dude, I was walking to work and like usual, he just happened to be coming through and he pulled up like if I wanted to ride. Yeah, he gave me a ride, we was talking about it. I told him about some recordings I had to do. It was the recordings I did after July 4th that I had to get rid of, you know what I mean? But I was saying that I was recording, he thought I was recording in the studio because usually when brothers say that they're recording, it's all about music, you know what I mean? So I said, hell nah, Trey. We got too many rappers out here already, man. You're the new African rapper. So we started talking about telling him about what I was recording and shit. So what up, Trey? You know I'm not lying about that, you know what I mean? I know you probably got 100 or so friends and followers and people you know online, you know what I mean? Just let them know. Listen to what that brother got to say. Just pick up a book and pick up a voter registration. You ain't even got to pick up a card no more. You can do it online now. Like, you're a citizen of the United States of America, yo, if you're black and born in America. You know what the fuck that means? You got Africans paying damn near $20,000 just for their kids to get a visa to come to America. I'm just saying, man. I digress. But let me read that paragraph again, yo. That was awesome. It says, during our domestication, our parents and siblings gave their opinions about us without even thinking. We believed their opinions and we lived in fear over these opinions, like not being good at swimming or sports or riding. Someone gives an opinion and says, look, this girl is ugly. The girl listens, believes she is ugly, and grows up with the idea that she is ugly. It doesn't matter how beautiful she is. As long as she has that agreement, she will believe that she is ugly. That is the spell she is under. By hooking our attention, the word can enter our mind and change a lot of belief for better or for worse. Another example, you may believe you're stupid and you may have believed this for as long as you can remember. This agreement can be very tricky, causing you to do a lot of things just to ensure that you are stupid. You may do something and think to yourself, I wish I was smart, but I must be stupid or I wouldn't have done it. The mind goes in hundreds of different directions, and you could spend days getting hooked by just that one belief in your own stupidity. Then one day someone hooks your attention and uses the word, lets you know that you're not stupid. You believe what the other person says and make a new agreement. As a result, you no longer feel or act stupid. The whole spell is broken just by the power of the word. Conversely, if you believe you're stupid and somebody hooks your attention and says, Yes, you are really the most stupid person I have ever met. The agreements will be reinforced and become even stronger. Now let us see what the word impeccability means. Impeccability means without sin. Impeccability comes from the Latin peccatus, P-E-C-A-T-U-S, which means sin. The I am in impeccability means without. So impeccability means without sin. Religions talk about sin and sinners, but let's understand what it really means to sin. A sin is anything you do, is anything that you do which goes against yourself. Everything you feel or believe or say that goes against yourself is a sin. You go against yourself when you judge or blame yourself for anything. Being without sin is exactly the opposite. Being impeccable is not going against yourself. But when you are impeccable, you take responsibility for your actions, but you do not judge or blame yourself. From this point of view, the whole concept of sin changes from something moral or religious to something common sense. Sin begins with rejection of yourself. Self-rejection is the biggest sin that you commit. In religious terms, self-rejection is a mortal sin, which leads to death. Impeccability, on the other hand, leads to life. Being impeccable with your word is not using the word against yourself. If I see you in the street and I call you stupid, it appears that I'm using the word against you. But really, I'm using my word against myself, because you're going to hate me for this, and you're hating me, and your hating me is not good for me. Therefore, if I get angry and with my words send all that emotional poison to you, I'm using the word against myself. If I love myself, I will express that love in my interactions with you. And then I am being impeccable with the word, because that action will produce a like reaction. If I love you, then you will love me. If I insult you, you will insult me. If I have gratitude for you, you will have gratitude for me. If I'm selfish with you, you will be selfish with me. If I use the word to put a spell on you, you're going to put a spell on me. Being impeccable with your word is the correct use of your energy. It means to use your energy in the direction of truth and love for yourself. If you make an agreement with yourself to be impeccable with your word, just with that intention, the truth will manifest through you and clean all the emotional poison that exists within you. But making this agreement is difficult, because we have learned to do precisely the opposite. We have learned to lie as a habit of our communication with others, and more importantly with ourselves. We are not impeccable with the word. The power of the word is completely misused in hell. We use the word to curse, to blame, to find guilt, to destroy. Of course, we also use it in the right way, but not too often. Mostly we use the word to spread our personal poison, to express anger, jealousy, envy, and hate. The word is pure magic, the most powerful gift we have as humans, and we use it against ourselves. We plan revenge. We create chaos with the word. We use the word to create hate between different races, between different people, between families, between nations. We misuse the word so often, and this misuse is how we create and perpetuate the dream of hell. Misuse of the word is how we pull each other down and keep each other in a state of fear and doubt. Because the word is the magic that humans possess and misuse, of the word is black magic, we are using black magic all the time without knowing that our word is magic at all. There is a woman, for example, who was intelligent and had a very good heart. She had a daughter whom she adored and loved very much. One night she came home from a very bad day and walked tired, full of emotional tension, and with a terrible headache. She wanted peace and quiet, but her daughter was singing and jumping happily. The daughter was unaware of how her mother was feeling. She was in her own world, in her own dream. She felt so wonderful. She was jumping and singing louder and louder, expressing her joy and love. She was singing so loud that it made her mother's headache even worse. And at a certain moment, the mother lost control. Angrily, she looked at her beautiful little girl and said, "Shut up! You have an ugly voice. Can you just shut up?" The truth is that the mother's tolerance for any noise was non-existent. It was not that the little girl's voice was ugly, but the daughter believed what her mother said, and in that moment she made an agreement with herself. After that, she no longer sang because she believed her voice was ugly and she would bother anyone who heard it. She became shy at school, and if she was asked to sing, she refused. Even speaking to others became difficult for her. Everything changed in the little girl because of this new agreement. She believed she must repress her emotions in order to be accepted and loved. Whenever we hear an opinion and believe it, we make an agreement, and it becomes part of our belief system. This little girl grew up, and even though she had a beautiful voice, she never sang again. She developed a whole complex from one spell. This spell was cast upon her by the one who loved her the most, her own mother. Her mother didn't notice what she did with her words. She didn't notice that she used black magic and put a spell on her daughter. She didn't know the power of her word, and therefore she isn't to blame. She did what her own mother, father, and others had done to her in many ways. She misused the word. How many times do we do this with our own children? We give them these types of opinions, and our children carry their black magic for years and years. People who love us do black magic on us, but they don't know what they do. That is why we must forgive them, and they don't know what they do. Another example, you awake in the morning feeling very happy. You feel so wonderful, you stay 1 or 2 hours in front of the mirror making yourself beautiful. Well, one of your best friends says, "What has happened to you? You look so ugly. Look at the dress you're wearing. You look ridiculous." That's it. That is enough to put you all the way down in hell. Maybe this girlfriend just told you this to hurt you, and she did. She gave you an opinion with all the power of her word behind it. If you accept the opinion, it becomes an agreement now, and you put all your power into that opinion. That opinion becomes black magic. These types of spells are difficult to break. The only thing that can break a spell is to make a new agreement based on truth. The truth is the most important part of being impeccable with your word. On one side of the sword are the lies which create black magic. On the other side of the sword is the truth which has the power to break the spell of black magic. Only the truth will set us free. Looking at everyday human interactions, imagine how many times we cast spells on each other with our word. Over time, this interaction has become the worst form of black magic, and we call it gossip. Gossip is black magic at its very worst because it is pure poison. We learn how to gossip by agreement. When we were children, we heard the adults around us gossiping all the time, openly giving their opinions about other people. They even had opinions about people they didn't know. Emotional poison was transferred along with the opinions, and we learned this as the normal way to communicate. Gossiping has become the main form of communication in human society. It has become the way we feel close to each other because it makes us feel better to see someone else feel as badly as we do. There is an old expression that says, "Misery likes company," and people who are suffering in hell don't want to be all alone. Fear and suffering are an important part of the dream of the planet. They are how the dream of the planet keeps us down. Yo, I gotta pay homage to DC. That straight DC Bama move, huh? That was the first track I got crunk to before I knew what crunk was, before Lil Jon put out the word crunk out there. You know what I mean? And Timmy had that. Was a part owner at the box. Y'all remember the box? Them days. Now let me stop. Emotional poison was transferred along with the opinions, and we learned this as the normal way to communicate. Gossiping has become the main form of communication in human society. It has become the way we feel close to each other, because it makes us feel better to see someone else feel as badly as we do. There's an old expression that says misery likes company, and the people who are suffering in hell don't want to be all alone. Fear and suffering are an important part of the dream of the planet. They are how the dream of the planet keeps us down. Using the analogy of the human mind as a computer, gossip can be compared to a computer virus. A computer virus is a piece of, like Trump is a computer virus in American democracy. But his kind of virus can be a cure at the same time. He's like a vaccine that doubles as an antidote. Or he's like a virus that doubles as an antidote for that virus. I'm sorry, did I just use vaccine and antidote in this same campaign? The scenario in my head, you know what I mean? I'm thinking about some other things right now in my mind that I can't really get into, but. Using the analogy of the human mind as a computer, gossip can be compared to a computer virus. A computer virus is a piece of computer language written in the same language all the other codes are written, but with a harmful intent. This code is inserted into the program of your computer when you least expect it, and most of the time without your awareness. After this code has been introduced, your computer doesn't work quite right, or it doesn't function at all because the codes get so mixed up with so many conflicting messages that it stops producing good results. Okay, just for the sake of context, a lot of the potential people that are going to be listening to this right now wouldn't realize that this was originally written in 1997, you know what I mean? So, yeah, computer viruses was a thing. It was a thing that people knew. Yeah, people knew about. Yeah, computers were a thing. But Bill Gates was still only 10 years into his promise to have a PC in every American home by the millennium. So, yeah. After this code has been introduced, your computer doesn't work quite right, or it doesn't function at all because the codes get so mixed up with so